It's really, really a pleasure for me to introduce Yehuda to you. It's a really special kind of occasion for me because I met Yehuda a long time ago when he was really just a kid, 21, just out of the Army. I was working for the Refuser Solidarity Network at that time. It was after I'd finished working at AFSC, but I'd been bringing people over for years. And I went for the first time to meet with the Refuser groups in Israel. I had not spent so much time in Israel before that, but one of the things particularly was to meet this new group, and I met them at the home of a member of Ish Gevul. I met Yehuda, and it was in 2005, right? And they were amazing. They were young. They were just out of Hebron. The impact of that experience, the impact of being soldiers in the occupation was obviously very, very powerful. And they had created this group with the exhibit and the testimonies. And I guess Yehuda and I kind of bonded. So I managed to arrange to bring them over for their first national tour. It was not Yehuda the first time, he keeps reminding me. It was somebody else, but they were in 2005. And he was here in 2006. And I haven't seen him really since then, because part of being on that trip made me spend a lot more time in Israel, even with the dearest of people that I loved dearly and who were my friends, than I ever had before. But it also made me kind of crazy, because it was feeling, I felt like I was in a kind of Salvador Dali canvas. And I said to Yehuda, I'm not coming back to Israel anymore after this. And if you ever want to see me again, you're going to have to be where I am. And I don't care where that is. And it can be in South Africa if I'm there. It can be anywhere in the world but Israel. But it would be really nice if it would be in Seattle. So guess what? He called 10 years later and said that they had this new book out and that he wondered if I would be willing to organize a tour along the West Coast. And he said he wanted to see me again. So of course I said yes, although I don't know, at this point in my life, I haven't done many organizing tours where I've had to drive hundreds of miles each week. But nonetheless, it has been a remarkable tour. And I have heard and learned from Yehuda as he has matured immensely and developed a kind of intellect and an awareness and an ability to talk about the occupation in ways that make the significance and importance of our continuing to talk about the occupation, which I think some of us have not done in the recent past, very, very important and very powerful, and nobody that I know can do it better than Yehuda. So listen carefully. The book is amazing. We will be selling it. He will be signing it, and I'm going to make him sit at the table to do that so he can't be stopped by a million people on the way.
Good evening. That's me when I was still young, so to speak, yeah? As if I'm too old already. I'll maybe say a few words about myself to introduce where I come from, how I got to where we are now, and maybe a few words about breaking the silence. As I understood, at least most of us have some background about what's going on in the occupied territories. So maybe once I finish to introduce breaking the silence and the stuff that we do, I'll kind of like dive into the book and try to kind of like scan very quick through the book to talk a bit about what it's all about. And I hope that's going to be good for us to start more of a conversation after. So I'm today 30 years old. This is me when I was 20, when I was 18 years old, 19 years old, more or less. I grew up in Jerusalem. The reason why I have a North American accent when I speak English is because both of my parents are from North America. My father is originally from Toronto. My mother is from the States. I grew up in Jerusalem. I was born in Jerusalem, grew up in Jerusalem. I'm a practicing Orthodox Jew. I don't know how much of this means to all of you. I grew up in what you would call the political right in Israel. I did my high school in a settlement in the West Bank, near Ramallah. My sister's a settler in the West Bank today. My cousins used to be settlers in Gaza before the disengagement in 2005. So that's more or less in terms of my personal background. And when I graduated high school, I joined the IDF, the Israeli Defense Forces. In Israel, we have a draft. Men serve for 3 years, women for 2 years. If you're in good health condition, you'll be sent to be a combat soldier. And that's what I was. I joined the IDF in March 2001, served for 3 years till March 2004. I was an infantry combat soldier and a commander, and I ended my service as a company sergeant. A company is a group of around 120 soldiers. 2 years of my service were in the West Bank, and this is actually a photo of me and the Wailing Wall. During basic training, when you're a soldier, after a few weeks in the military, 5-6 weeks, I don't remember exactly, you have this very, very powerful ceremony in the Wailing Wall of swearing loyalty to the army, to the country. So that's me. A bit tired, because that's how soldiers are in basic training. Not much time to sleep. I finished my training. I became an infantry combat soldier later on. I don't know if you can recognize me. Yeah, in the back. That's me graduating my sergeant training. I became a sergeant, a commander, and then a sergeant. And basically, as I said, served 2 years in the West Bank. Out of these 2 years, I served 14 months in Hebron. Hebron is the largest Palestinian city in the West Bank, down in the south of the West Bank. I was there more or less around 7 months as a soldier, and then I came back as a commander for 7 more months. And even though I come from where I come from, in terms of my political background, meaning coming from the political right in Israel, still throughout my service I had many doubts whether what we're doing is the right thing to do. I think especially in Hebron, many soldiers who go through that city find themselves asking themselves questions that otherwise they would never ask. But the thing is that when you're a soldier, you always find a way to move on. Yeah, there is really no time to continue the thoughts and ask the real questions. There is always things that are greater and bigger than you. There's orders, there's missions. And I think the most important thing that there is this bond of comradeship. It doesn't matter what you think about what you're doing. It doesn't matter how many questions you have. If you are next in line to wake up 5 o'clock in the morning, replace your friend at 6 o'clock, and start the morning shift, you're going to do it because that's what we do. That's how the military works. Later on, I became a commander, and in a way, as a commander, there was even less room for questions. Yeah, there's more responsibility. Things need to be done. That's how military works. You can wait. Yeah, there is a timeline. It was only towards the end of my service when I was a company sergeant, the last 4, 5, 6 months of my service, a lot of spare time, sat down with myself, started to plan my life afterwards, yeah? 5, 6 months from now, I'm gonna become a civilian, start my life as an adult. Who am I? What I wanna do? What I wanna do when I'll grow up? Which kind of life I wanna live? And in a way, for me, that was a turning point. Yeah, this was, in a way, the first second in my adult life that I stopped thinking as a professional combat soldier and started thinking as a civilian. Yeah, it's kind of like the first second you take one step out of the box, look from outside, and suddenly things look very different. Yeah, it's, in a way, it's the second you stop thinking as a professional combat soldier and you start to think as a civilian, I found myself in a place where I lost justification for 90% of actions I took part in. Suddenly the way I justified things to myself throughout my service didn't make sense anymore. And it is that strong sense that something was wrong that brought me to where I am today. I had no idea what to do about it. I was far away from being able to articulate it the way I can do today, but I felt that I cannot continue my life without doing something about it. So I turned to the only people that I could turn to, which was my comrades and my unit. Yeah, they're the only ones who could understand what I'm talking about. They've been there with me. And I started this conversation inside our unit, and very quick, I was very surprised to discover that we all felt the same. Yeah, everyone I spoke with, we all felt something, somewhere in the back of our mind, we all felt that something was wrong. And that's how Breaking the Silence was born. So we started having these conversations inside our barracks about things we've done and seen. And the one thing that shocked us very fast was the realization that people back home in Israel have no clue. Our own society, they had no clue of what we've done. Our own society that sent us to do the job in the occupied territories had no idea of what doing the job means. So we decided to bring Hebron to Tel Aviv. That was our slogan. It's not that Hebron is the worst place I served in, yeah? I served in the big operations in 2002, 2003, all over the West Bank. But Hebron was a place that we served all of us together for 14 months so we could actually tell a story about the place. And that's why we've chosen to start from there. So I got out of the military in March 2004, and in June 1st, 2004, we opened a photo exhibit, video testimonies, and Tel Aviv. We were 65 people from my unit, our photos on the walls, our faces on the screen, video testimonies talking about what we've done. We had no clue what we're doing, no idea where it's going, no plans. It just seemed like the right thing to do. And the only problem was that once we opened the gallery, we found ourselves in the middle of a huge mess. It was the first time that a group of veterans have organized themselves this way. We became the story of the country, all over the news. Over 7,000 people came to visit the gallery during the 3 weeks that it was open. We were invited to present the exhibit in the Israeli parliament for a full month. Yeah, the political climate was very, very different than today. And in a way, it was the huge mess that what we had to say created, together with the fact that we met other veterans who served in other units and other areas in the occupied territories and had the same story, just like we had to say, about Hebron. It's these two things that brought us to continue Breaking the Silence to where we are today, 9 years after. And what we do in Breaking the Silence, since then till today, is very simple, mainly two things. The heart of our work is documenting soldiers' testimonies, videoing, audiotaping soldiers and ex-soldiers about their time in the occupied territories. Until today, we've interviewed over 950 men and women, all of whom served as conscripts since the beginning of the Second Intifada till today. So everyone is more or less my age. People are 20, 21 years old, 32, 33, 34. How old can you be if you join the draft around the age of 18, around the year of 2000, yeah? Do the math, doesn't take you too far. These testimonies, we cross-check, verify, and then we publish them in different ways. And this book is just one platform of how to get the story out. And the second thing we do is we try to use our personal experience and the testimonies we gather as an educational and advocacy tool. So we do a lot of lectures back home, panel discussions, and we take mainly Israelis to tours to Hebron, to the south of Hebron, around Ramallah. So in a way, if Breaking the Silence started with trying to bring Hebron to Tel Aviv, now we're trying to bring Tel Aviv to Hebron, yeah? Trying to bring Israelis mainly to see firsthand what occupation is, how does it smell, how does it feel? Yeah, firsthand to see the reality on the ground. Just so you understand, you get a bit of scope of our work. In today's capacity, we interview around 100 new veterans every year. Around one-third of the testifiers, of the soldiers who testify to Breaking the Silence every year, around one-third of them do it during their conscription time in the military. Yeah, so they're still conscripts in uniform. So we're not just talking about stories from 2002 when I served in, we're talking about stories from 2012, 2013, today, tomorrow. And we conduct around 450 tours and lectures a year. So most of our work is done, not most, sorry, but a significant part of our work is done with young Israelis before draft. So about one-third of our work is taking youngsters from youth movements, high schools, pre-military academies. That is, for us in Breaking the Silence, the most important target group. And if I'll try to put into few words what it is we're trying to do and why we're doing what we're doing. So for us, the story is very simple. Breaking the science operates on a very simple logic. We're now civilians back in our society, coming to our society saying this, look guys, you sent us there to do the job. We went there, we've done it, we're back home. We're not going to tell you who to vote for, but there is one thing we demand from you, and that is sit down and listen to what we've done in your name. Yeah? It's about trying to hold up a mirror in front of our society, demanding from our society to take moral and civil responsibility for what's being done in its name. It's about trying to force a public discussion about the moral price tag of maintaining a prolonged occupation over another people. It's about trying to bring up the one question that I believe is the most important question in a democratic society. And that is, what are our moral boundaries as a society? Yeah, what are our moral red lines? To which extent we stand beyond our military and when we say no, not in our name. It's obvious we're against the occupation, otherwise there was no reason for us to do what we do. But anything to do with how the occupation is going to end, what's the roadmap from here, not our job. We are here to say what is occupation and ask from everyone and from ourselves to take a stand against it. Now, throughout the years, the way we worked was very simple. Our tool is soldiers' testimonies, right? We are here to tell the story of the occupation through our perspective, through the perspective, through the eyes of people who are implementing the occupation. So we would just choose a topic that we want to shed light on. I don't know, the treatment of children and minors in the occupied territories by the military, experience of female soldiers in the occupied territories, Operation Cast Lead in Gaza in 2009, yeah? Different topics that we decide we want to campaign on. And we would just put together a bunch of testimonies, paste them in a booklet, 20, 30, 50, 60, 70 stories. This is what soldiers said they've done about this topic. Let's have a conversation over it. No analysis, nothing more, nothing less. Soldiers' testimonies. And now let's have a conversation. It was 4 years ago, yeah, and that's kind of like the story of the book. 4 years ago, as we were approaching the 10th anniversary of the Second Intifada, 2010, after interviewing over 700 veterans, we felt we could actually say something more. And in a way, we've taken upon ourselves the challenge to try to tell the story of how the Israeli military operates, how the Israeli military is controlling the Palestinians in the occupied territories. Of course, through the perspective of soldiers, of military, right? Because that's our material. Yeah, it's testimonies of soldiers on the ground. And the result of that task, in a sense, of that mission, is this book. I'll maybe say a few words about what you won't find in the book, and then a few words about our conclusions, and then I'll kind of like really very quickly go through our methodology, how we worked, and explain a bit what's in the book. So what we don't have in the book, this is not an attempt to try to tell the whole story of how Israel is controlling Palestinians. Not even close to that, yeah? There are many arms of control that my government has over Palestinians that we don't have access to. The judiciary system, Secret Service, yeah, there's... What we can speak is from the perspective of ground troops, of military, on the ground. Another thing we don't claim to know, and I think I'm not interested in going into it today, is the intentions behind. The testifiers of breaking the silence are not the generals in the army who sit behind closed doors around a table and formulate the policy. I don't claim to know why they do, why they decide what they decide. What are the intentions? What I do claim to know is what at the end of the day we're implementing, how we're implementing their decisions, and what it leaves behind. Yeah? And that's in a way the way we've done this work around the book. It's very simple. After you interview over 700 people from all IDF units who serve in the occupied territories, and you look for the bigger picture, and you find that a soldier who served in Gaza in 2001 says something, and a soldier who served in Hebron in 2002, and a soldier who served in Qalqilia in 2003, and in Nablus in 2005, and in Jenin 2006, and I think you get where I'm going, yeah? And if they all talk the same, probably there is something bigger and greater, right? Probably the story is, and that's basically how we built our analysis in this book. So what's our conclusion? I'll say in a few words. When we came to put together this book, when we came to do this research, when we tried to understand what the Israeli military is doing in the occupied territories, we came from the perspective that we grew up on. As Israeli Jews, we grew up believing that what the IDF is doing in the occupied territories is defending Israel from terrorism. There's Palestinian terrorism against Israel. Israel has a military, and our job is to defend the country. Makes sense. You know what? We're not only defending the state of Israel. We're also defending Israeli settlers and settlements. Look, it doesn't matter if you agree or disagree with the presence of settlements in the occupied territories. You can think that they're wrong, you can think, but as long as we don't have a solution to the conflict and they're there, they're Israeli civilians, and they deserve protection just like every other Israeli civilian, right? Makes sense. So to speak, if I'll try to put into a very, a small sentence, a catchy sentence, what the Israeli army is doing in the occupied territories is, quote unquote, playing defense. Playing defense, yeah? The thing is that once we start to look through the testimonies, the entire archive and collection of testimonies that we had, and you start to put one story near the other, and you start to look for the big picture, you understand very, very quick that playing defense is a very small part of the story. What we're mainly doing is we're playing offense. And it's not that we're playing offense against terrorism. What we're mainly doing is about maintaining and preserving and entrenching Israel's absolute military control over Palestinians. Yeah, so what we are mainly busy with is to maintain and sustain the status quo of Israel's military control over Palestinians. Yeah, you know, for years, there is a political process in the discussion, in the language, in the talk, is that we are in a process of going out. It's just a matter of finding the right formulation of things. If you listen to soldiers how the occupation operates, you understand that we are in a process of going in. If you think, you know, when one comes to think about military occupations, you know, we always think about these realities as temporary situations. There was a war, you conquered a territory, you can't just disappear tomorrow, right? You have some responsibility, you need to manage a place just to make sure that things are okay, that things are run smooth. Leave some political space, allow some institutions to emerge that someone can replace you once you leave out. But don't worry, you are counting the days. At the end of the day, you are out. You know what, today there is also other things we do. Sometimes we invade countries to take down regimes. But still, even when we do that, after we take down the regime, we start with what we call nation building. Now, I'm not here to argue whether it's working or not, not my job. But what I'm here to say is that even when we do that, yeah, the framing is that we are not staying forever, right? We are on the way out. That's why we have the counterinsurgency manual, and that's why we talk about winning hearts and minds, and that's why we talk about building institutions, and that's why, right? Because we are not planning to stay. What I'm saying is that if you listen very carefully to soldiers, how the Israeli occupation operates on the ground, you understand that the occupation on the ground, the military behaves as if there is no end in sight. And there's no exit strategy. Now look, I'm not going to have the time to lay down the whole argument, yeah, step by step how we got to the conclusion, but I hope I'm going to be able to kind of like give us a taste, okay? So the way we've done it is we've taken all Israel's military actions in the occupied territories and divided it to four pillars: code names, strategies, titles. Look, the book was published in Hebrew 3 years ago, and I still don't know which words to use. But that's basically the four chapters of the book. And these code names are words, yeah, are phrases that every Israeli soldier is very familiar with. And almost every Israeli civilian is very familiar with. Once the average Israeli soldier or civilian hears them, actually the connotation he has from them is very positive. And he thinks of something very specific. And what we're trying to do in this book is we're trying to compare what the average Israeli hears or thinks of when he hears these code names, words, and what they actually mean if you listen to soldiers' testimonies. Yeah, and that's how we slowly build the argument. So the four chapters of the book are: chapter number one is Sikul. Sikul is a Hebrew word, stands for prevention. Yeah, probably you've never heard this word before, Sikul. The second word is Hafrada, separation. The third word, and this is where I get my BA in Chinese, Mirkam Chaim, fabric of life. The fourth word is Achifat Chok, law enforcement. Okay, these are the four chapters of the book. So let's try to do this decoding job, at least in the first chapter, before we open it for a conversation. So the first chapter is called Sikul, prevention. Prevention is a very, very defensive word. Agree with me? The word Sikul doesn't mean anything to you, probably, but the average Israeli who hears Sikul, the first thing that comes to his mind is probably what we call in Hebrew Sikul Memukad, targeted prevention. Yeah, and I see the Hebrew speaker in the crowd in the back kind of like nodding. What is targeted prevention? What is Sikul Memukad? That's the code name we use for assassinations in the media. So the scenario that comes to your mind is the most defensive thing you can think of, the ticking bomb scenario. There is a suicide bomber on the way to blow up a bus. With the bomb, you cannot arrest him. You're not going to allow him to blow up the bus, right? You'll send a drone, you'll send a chopper, you'll take him out. You targetly prevented him. You've done something very defensive. Saved many people. The thing is that if you listen to soldiers who serve in the military and the IDF to what prevention is, you understand that the concept of prevention in the Israeli military today is so wide that every defensive act you can ever think of and almost every offensive act you can ever think of is considered defensive, is considered prevention. And that widening of the concept of what prevention is, we can see if we follow every tactic that the military uses on the ground. So, of course, we don't have the time to go through all the tactics, right? But let's take just a few as example. So, because I already brought up assassinations, let's stick to assassinations. So, you start with assassinating people that you cannot arrest. Yeah, that's the only way to tackle the threat that they pose to you. And then you move on to assassinating people that you can arrest. But by assassinating them, rather than arresting them, you leave a greater impact on the board. And then you move on to assassinating people just for revenge. Yeah, in the peak of the second intifada, there were a couple of revenge attacks that the Israeli army carried out. For example, If I'm not mistaken, it was in February 19th, 2002. There was an attack on an IDF checkpoint near Ramallah in a Palestinian village called Inarik. 6 engineer soldiers were killed. The following night, 3 different special forces units were sent to revenge. The orders were very clear. 2 o'clock at night, Palestinian police checkpoints. Anyone at the checkpoint is doomed to die. Uniform, not uniform, doesn't matter. Armed, not armed. At the end of the evening, 15 Palestinian policemen are killed. One unit in Gaza, one unit in Ramallah, one unit in Nablus. Has nothing to do with the attack in Inarik, yeah? They took 6, we're going to take some. Now, anyone who understands the chain of command in the IDF and the deployment of the IDF knows that Gaza is under the control of what we call the Southern Command. West Bank is under what we call Central Command. These are 2 different generals. If you look at the kind of units that we're operating, they're also under different commands. So it doesn't take, you don't need to be a professor in order to understand that the only person that can order an attack like this is above the Central Command General, which is a deputy chief of staff, if not higher. Yeah, this is not a story of one officer that loses control. Let's take another example, arrests. So you start with arresting bad guys. Makes sense. Then you move on to arresting cousins of bad guys because you want to put pressure on the family, because you want to get intelligence, because. And then you move on to arresting, or you move on to what we call mass arrests, which is you go into a village, round up all the men from 20 to 50, from 25 to 35, from 20 to 40, yeah? Different times, different numbers, different ages. And we can go really on and on and on with every tactic that the military uses. But the peak of what prevention is what we call in the military making our presence felt. I don't know if you've heard this phrase before. What does it mean? Military logic, military way of thinking says this. If Palestinians will get the feeling that the army is all the time everywhere, they'll be afraid to attack. So what do you do to make them feel this way? You make your presence felt. How does it manifest itself? In different places, different ways. So if I'll just give you an example from Hebron, which is a city that I served in for almost 14 months. So Hebron is the largest Palestinian city in the West Bank, in the south of the West Bank. Around 180,000 Palestinians live in Hebron. It's a unique city by that it's the only Palestinian city as a whole, if you put aside East Jerusalem, that has an Israeli settlement in the heart of the city. So you have 850 settlers living in a city center of 180,000 Palestinians. Guarding them, you have 650 combat soldiers on a day-to-day basis, and I was one of these 650 soldiers for a while. So what do? You make your presence felt. How does it look like? You have 2 military patrols. One is in charge of the old city of Hebron. The other one is in charge of Palestinian neighborhoods around the old city. And that's their job, to make their presence felt. You start your night shift patrol 10 o'clock till 6 o'clock in the morning, 8-hour shift. Walk in the streets of the old city. Break into a house. It's not a house we have intelligence about. A random house. I'm the sergeant, I lead the patrol. Choose a random house, break into the house, wake up the family. Men one side, women the other side. Search the place. You can yourself imagine the dynamics. What happens when you break into a family, 2 o'clock at night, wake everyone up. Search the place, finish, go out to the street, knock on some doors, make some noise, run to the other corner of the street, invade another house, wake up the family, search, go out, run to the other corner of the old city, another random house. And that's basically how you pass your 8-hour shift. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, from September 2000, when the second Intifada started, till today, it didn't stop for 1 second. Yeah, the idea is very simple. Every Palestinian needs to feel the military is right here. Yeah, you never know when we're going to show up, when we're going to start, when we're going to end, how many we're going to be, what we're going to do. It's to do what we call in the military, ליצור תחושת נרדפות, to create the feeling of being chased. You know what? One more tactic, and then I'll finish this chapter. I don't know if you've heard this phrase before, or this concept, mock arrest. What is a mock arrest? As it sounds, a fake arrest. What is it? This is actually a tactic that we've been hearing more and more from soldiers who serve in the last 4 or 5 years. Because in the last 4 or 5 years, as opposed to my time in the military, I served in the Second Intifada. Palestinian violence was very serious in the West Bank. But in the last 4 or 5 years, the West Bank is very safe for Israeli soldiers. So we hear more and more of mock arrests. What is a mock arrest? You have a new unit in town. They just finished training. The first time they're deployed. You don't want the first arrest operation they carry out to be the real thing. So you send them on a mock arrest before. You choose the most peaceful, quiet Palestinian village in the area where you served. Open an aerial photo of the village. Choose a random house in the village. Pick up the phone. Call the Secret Service. Make sure that the guy living in the house you've chosen randomly is innocent. And that by operating on him, you are not interfering in intelligence gathering operations that the Secret Service has in the area. Once you get the go, meaning he's innocent, and you're not interfering in Secret Service business in the area, you come in the middle of the night, you surround the house, grab the guy, handcuffed, blindfolded, as if it's a real arrest. Put him in a Jeep. After 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, someone goes on the radio, says, end of exercise, stop the Jeep, release the guy, go back to the base, and go to sleep. So you're probably wondering, why the hell to do it? Actually, soldiers who get these orders usually also wonder why the hell we're doing it. We know the guy is innocent, so why are we doing it? And they asked their commanders, and you know what many soldiers heard back? Mainly two reasons. One is training. Training is very important. As close training can be to reality, better. So if you can do it on a real Palestinian village, on a real Palestinian house, and a real Palestinian man, better. Makes sense. But the second reason is even more interesting. Think of it, a mock arrest is just another advanced way of making your presence felt. You go in the middle of the night to the village, surround the house, yeah? Some noise, some movement, lights, shouting, military movement in the village, people wake up, they know you're here. They see you're surrounding a house. They see you're arresting a person that they know is innocent. They're not stupid. Yeah, people in the village usually know. So they start to ask questions. Why the hell are you arresting him? He's innocent. But then they see that you released him. So what the hell is going on here? Arrest, released. Is he a collaborator? Yes, no. And they don't find the answers, so they're even more scared. Yeah, because when things are rational, right? When you know what's waiting behind a corner, you can calculate. You can decide whether you want to test, whether you want to obey or disobey, whether you want to take risk. But when you have no idea what's waiting around the corner, that's when you're really terrified, right? Yeah, that's why we actually, the name of the first chapter is, we called it Prevention Intimidating the Palestinian Population. Because when the goal is intimidation, The lack of logic is the perfect logic. Yeah, the lack of order is the perfect order, right? You're starting to get the idea where the American publisher got the name of the book, Our Harsh Logic. In a way, prevention is a reality of constant intimidation of everyone, everywhere, all the time. There is nothing a Palestinian can do in order not to be intimidated, right? He always, all the time, everywhere he goes, he needs to be prevented all the time, right? The second chapter is Hafrada, separation. I know that in the American context, separation is not something that has a good connotation, but actually in Israel, it's very different. In Israel, it's basically the concept of, you know, what are you talking about? Things will be great. Palestinians will be in Palestine. Israelis in Israel. We'll have a two-state solution. Peace in the Middle East, right? As Prime Minister Barak used to say, they will be there, we will be here. Yeah? Two nations, side by side, everything will be great. But you don't need to be an expert in the realities in the occupied territories to know that separation is not just between us and them. That's a very, very, very small part of what separation is about. Separation is mainly between them and them. Yeah, separation is mainly divide and rule, divide and conquer. Fragmentation. And again, we don't have the time. We can go through into the permit regime and into restrictions and physical obstacles and legal obstacles that separate and fragment the space, the land, the West Bank from Gaza, and the West Bank from the Jordan Valley, and the West Bank from East Jerusalem, and the north from the south, and the cities from their rural parts, and a farmer from his land, and the separation barrier. And we can go on and on and on, but that's why you have the book, not me. The third chapter is Fabric of Life. There is something I'm not going to go into. Another reason why you should get the book. And the fourth chapter is Law Enforcement. Now, in this chapter, what we try to say, what we try to highlight, is basically two things. And allow me, even before I continue, just to remind us one thing. We talk about Israeli forces enforcing law in the occupied territories, but we just need to remind ourselves that we call it law and we write it. L-A-W? The same way we write the law that we live under, but it's not the same. It's not law by the people for the people. It's by Israel for Israel, yeah? So when we talk about law enforcement, there's two things I want to kind of like highlight. First one is a very, very basic thing, and that's how we call the chapter, dual regime. Just to remind us the fact that in the occupied territories, we basically have two legal systems. We have two communities living there, settlers and Palestinians, who live under two different legal systems, enforced by two different executive branches of the government. Right? So, even though it's not Israel proper, even the most right-wing Israeli government, which is the present government we have, never enforced Israeli sovereignty over the vast majority of the West Bank. And if you put aside East Jerusalem, over all the rest of the West Bank and Gaza. So the sovereign power in the West Bank is the Israeli military. By international law, by Israeli law, the Israeli military is supposed to protect the people who live there. As a soldier serving on the ground, my orders are very clear. I'm there to protect the settlers. If I see a settler attacking a Palestinian, not my job. Best thing I can do is go on a radio, call my headquarters, ask them to call the headquarters of the Israeli civilian police, to send an Israeli civilian police car to come and take care of the matter. Yeah, so we have this division of labor. Now, the Israeli police doesn't do their job, not because they don't want to, because they're not supposed to. Yeah, because there's no political backup, because. But of course, again, the discrimination is not only with the fact that law is not enforced on the settlers. Discrimination is also built in the legal system that both communities live under. Because Palestinians who live under military law have a bit less rights than Israeli settlers who live under civilian law. Yeah, there is a bit of a difference between civilian law and military law. But this is the first thing. The second thing we're trying to show, or we're showing, I believe, not trying, in this chapter is, look, I must say, I'll say the truth. This is actually something I haven't seen, I didn't see before we started working on this book. For years, I had a thought that if you look from the perspective of the military, of the Israeli military, the IDF, your mission is to control the occupied territories, control the Palestinians who live there. Life for the military would have been so much better if you didn't have 500,000 settlers walking in between their legs. Who needs these civilians, right? They just make things more complicated. Suddenly there's more people, you need to protect them, they take over hilltops, you need to do that, and then they have roads, and, you know, they make things complicated. For the military, the best is when everything is very simple. There's black, white, us, them, good guys, bad, so easy. But now you have all these settlements, and it's just... The thing is that if you listen very, very carefully to soldiers' testimonies, you will actually understand and realize that the system has found a way to turn the settlements into an advantage. Today, the settlers and the settlements are just another arm of control over Palestinians. And I don't just mean with the fact of fragmentation of space. Yeah, with the fact that when you have a settlement, you break, yeah, you divide the land. I'm talking about things that are 100% pure security issues, military issues. For example, if I'm a soldier during my training, I'm sent for a week or two to guard a settlement. Who do you think gives me my orders? What my mission is? What my rules of engagements are? Who? Is it my direct officer? Usually no. So who does brief me? Settler security officer. Yeah, every settlement has a settler security officer appointed by the Ministry of Defense. If we'll try to kind of like bring it to the American reality, every settler has a sheriff, every settlement has a sheriff, yeah? And he basically briefs me what my mission is. Where Palestinians are allowed to walk and where not, around the settlement, what I'm supposed to do to them. Every week, yeah, the West Bank, the deployment of the military is in 7 regional brigades in the West Bank. Every week we have meetings, security assessment, intelligence briefing, yeah? Who sits around the table? Brigadier General, as deputy, operational officer, battalion commanders of the units that are deployed, and who else? Representatives from the Central Security. And I can continue on and on and on with giving you dozens, if not hundreds, of more tiny examples like that. So you get to understand that the lack of law enforcement on settlers is not just because there is no political backup. It's because the system is built in a way that it's not any more clear where starts the civilian, ends the civilian, where starts the military, ends the military. Yeah, and one of the basic things we know from our life is that a system cannot go against itself, right? So I think we've touched some things that explain to us, I think we've touched some aspects that explain to us that we are not about distinguishing between the bad guys and the good guys, that we are not about, yeah, many things that we can build together that will explain us all how we got to our conclusion. But the last thing I want to say before I shut up, I know I spoke for too long, actually. You know, I don't say it in order to tap ourselves on the back, but the American publisher gave a title for the book, Our Harsh Logic. Yeah, this book was translated to other languages, German, Dutch, French. You know, in French, they called it the Black Book of the Israeli Occupation. They've looked for a provocative, you know, they wanted to sell books. As opposed to Judith, I'm not here to sell books. when we published the book in Hebrew, we looked for a title that actually tells the story of what it is we're trying to say, what it is we found in our analysis. And we called the book Kibush Ashtachim. Now, it's very difficult to translate to English, but if I'll translate it literally, it's the occupation of the territories. Because what we tried to say, because what we understood is that for a lot of people, the Israeli occupation is an historical event. There was a war, 6 days in June 1967. Yeah? Israel occupied the territories. No. If you understand how the military operates, you understand that the Israeli occupation is not an historical event. The Israeli occupation of the territories is an ongoing offensive campaign that takes place everywhere all the time. It's not just that every house we build in a settlement, we physically reoccupy the territories. It's also every Palestinian house we break into the middle of the night to create the feeling of being chased in the whole population, the territories are being reoccupied. And every random checkpoint we put in between villages to disrupt the routine of the area, of the people living in the area, the territories are being reoccupied. Yeah? Every step, yeah, we're digging in. And I think if you accept this analysis, I think this gives a whole different meaning to this phrase that we hear a lot, which is the status quo. Yeah? Status quo is not anymore something frozen in the freezer that you can come back 10 years down the road. Yeah? Status quo is an offensive campaign making sure that we're staying. That they could never get together. That they will never be free. I think I'll shut up. There's a lot more to say, but thank God there is the watch clock in front of me. I'll be more than happy if there's any thoughts, comments, questions, or whatever. Yeah, please.
One is, how many Palestinians is the average soldier
killed? So the question was, how many Palestinians the average soldier kills during his service? So probably zero. Usually. Look, like seriously talking, if we look at things, Israeli soldiers don't go and kill people all the time. Yeah, not even part of the time. This is not what the story is about. And I don't think, I'll say it in a different way. I would say it that if we are in a place that in order to be terrified, and in order to be morally disturbed from a reality, soldiers need to go and kill civilians every day. I think we are a problem, and not the soldiers who do it, in a way. We're far away from that reality. The story is not killing. Yeah? Most soldiers don't get even close to these things. The story is a regime that is designed to make sure that millions of people will not be free. Yeah, that's the story. Yeah.
My understanding that many Israeli soldiers who aren't particularly religious still experience the kind of dissonance you just experienced in yourself. And then as a result of that, the rate of suicide and drug taking after service is quite high. Now,
where do we start? About soldiers who are affected and how they are affected. There is actually quite a significant number of soldiers who commit suicide during their service, but we don't really know how many of them. This number we don't really know. It's something that is hidden from public eye. But Israeli soldiers who after their service take drugs, that's normal. That's basically how we do it, right? You finish military service, you work a bit, put some money aside, travel around the world, India, Australia, New Zealand, South Central America, take some drugs, loosen up, put things behind. That's fine. That's the way to try to move on from an experience of 3 years in the military. And in a way, that's kind of like this. This is part of this contract that you have between soldiers and society in order to keep and maintain the silence, right? We know that there is some bad stuff going on there. We know it wasn't easy, but okay. But you can go out very far away, puke and throw up. As long you come back within a year, 2 years, you know, SATs, university, and back in society, that's fine, right? That's okay. Just don't tell what's going on there, right? Because we don't want to be bothered if it's happening far away. How soldiers are influenced by the popular resistance, I wouldn't call it nonviolent. There is violence in these protests. I would call it non-armed, yeah, just to be very accurate. Most of these protests are not nonviolent. There are some protests that are pure nonviolent. Most of them are non-armed. What's interesting about it, and this is where, again, when you try to understand not only how do we create prevention, how do we prevent, also what we prevent from happening, yeah? The thing is that we don't prevent only terrorism. We prevent any kind of Palestinians who challenge our control and our rule, right? Because, you know, there is few Palestinian villages today in the West Bank that every Friday have non-armed struggle protests. For example, one of them is Nabi Salah, a small, tiny village in the center of the West Bank, about 550 people. And every Friday afternoon prayer, there is a march, 50, 60 people, slogans, flags, I don't know, speakers, hundreds of tear gas canisters, rubber bullets, sometimes dogs, night raids, arresting children. Why? No one can tell me that 50 Palestinians with slogans in the streets of Nabi Salah are a security threat to the state of Israel. Give me a break, right? But 50 Palestinians with slogans in the street of Nabi Salah are a serious threat to the absolute military control of Israel over Palestinians. So look, guys, we have a toolbox. We know how to operate. Option 1 till 100, anyone who stands up will meet the toolbox at the level that we deem necessary and the way that we think is important. Now, you're right. Popular resistance is nothing close to the Palestinian violence that I faced as a soldier. But what's interesting is that just like a revenge attack is a defensive act, yet taking down popular resistance is taking down terror in the eyes of most of the soldiers who deal with it. Okay, that's part of the story, sadly enough. About the movie The Gatekeepers, the thing is that if you really want the head of the Shin Bet to speak out about what he's done, it's going to take more than 60 or 70 or 80 minutes that the movie has. Watching this movie, you know, I don't really ask, it's not a question that I ask myself, are they hiding something from me? The one thing I ask myself is, what the hell brought the whole living ex of the Shin Bet, heads of the Shin Bet, to come together and speak the way they've done? Yeah, and when I try to answer this question, I'm really terrified. Yeah, they're probably very, very much afraid on where we're going. And that leads me to your question about how I see things and where I see the country's going. Look, the way I see it is that actually a prolonged occupation, the way we are conducting, a one we are conducting, is actually the greatest strategic threat to the state of Israel. You know, there is a word that we hear a lot in the discussion about Israel-Palestine in the last few years, and that is delegitimizing Israel. Heard that one? I actually believe that the greatest delegitimizer of Israel is my prime minister. And I'll explain why I'm saying it. I'm an Israeli Jew. I live in Israel. That's my home. Not going to leave. Doesn't matter what you want me to do. But the thought, the concept, that the only way that I'm as a Jew, me as a Jew, who believes that the Jewish people have a right to fulfill the right to self-determination in the land of Israel, the only way that I can fulfill my right of self-determination is if I make sure that Palestinians don't have the same rights like me, is the worst thing I can think of. And that's what the politics that my government is bringing to the table. Yeah, what is my government saying? Yeah, my prime minister is presenting a political mathematical equation that says this. The right of Israel to exist equals to the right of Israel to occupy Palestinians forever. Yeah, it's a concept that we're in a zero-sum game. It's either us or them. Better be us, they'll never be free. Now, if I'll go to Bibi Netanyahu today and put in front of him this political question, the right of Israel to exist equals to the right of Israel to occupy Palestinians forever, his answer will be, of course Israel has a right to occupy Palestinians forever. What do you mean? But if I will bring this political question in front of almost every normal human being in the world, his answer will be exactly the opposite. So Israel has no right to exist. And that's why I believe that the most important thing that we can do is to take the sharpest knife that we can find in our drawers and come in the middle of the sentence and cut it in the middle. There is one thing which is the right of Israel to exist. There is another thing, the right of Israel to occupy Palestinians forever, and that, hell no. And it doesn't matter how deep underground you'll dig, you cannot find an excuse that can justify this for me. Yeah, the occupation had to stop not tomorrow, not yesterday, 46 years ago. Yeah.
What actions are taken against the breaking the silence? What are you up against? And are you in any danger? And how is it you could walk around so freely and make the statements you just made in America?
Yeah. Okay. Look, first of all, in terms of what we face in Israel. Look, At the end of the day, I'm an Israeli Jew living in Israel. And that means I have privileges. Yeah, and it's not for no reason earlier I said bringing Hebron to Tel Aviv. Yeah? Because I think the story of Israel is it's a place where there is Hebron and there is Tel Aviv. And the story of Israel in that sense is a place where 46 years, our national project, yeah, our resources as a people go to maintain our control over Palestinians, but at the same time, breaking the silence can exist. And not only breaking the silence, many other groups. Yeah, that's the Tel Aviv and Hebron that you have in Israel. You know, apparently reality in life is not that simple. It's not black and white. Yeah? Things are not that easy. But actually, things are very easy. Because when you look at something like the occupation, it's very simple. Wrong. Immoral. From start till the end. But again, this is not Israel. This is the occupation. Many people don't know, but every word Breaking the Silence publishes goes through military censorship. Sounds crazy, huh? I hope you'll believe me when I'll tell you that actually the military censorship is one of the most progressive bodies in my government. No, you know, we're not about revealing state secrets, yeah? This is not the job of Breaking the Silence. We're not here about harming national security of the state of Israel, yeah? The story is to have a real conversation about what we're doing there. So, you know, if the military censorship erases a military code name for something from the testimony, this is not really important. Yeah? What is important is that we know the story of what we're doing. We understand what prevention is. And then we have to ask ourselves, whether we believe in a system that collectively punishes every Palestinian for being Palestinian all the time, everywhere. Politically speaking, of course, there are some public attacks against us. But I think that's fine. I think it's okay. I think that that's the price of living in a democracy. That's the price of freedom of speech. If I'm allowed to say what I'm allowed to say, people are allowed to call me a traitor. As long as it doesn't get to violence, makes sense to me. Because we're touching something that is very much at the heart of our society and our identity as a people. And people get angry and people get aggravated, it's fine, I think. When the government tries to tell me to shut up, that's where I think it becomes dangerous. Yeah, because no one gave the government the right to tell me what I'm allowed to say and what not, yeah? And in the recent governments we have, we see from time to time attempts to try to shrink space for civil society, I would call it, yeah? With different, trying to pass different legislation and different laws. But we can still operate. In terms of DCI, I don't know if I would go as far to say that there is a strategy to target children. I don't know if I would go, you know, as a person who served in the military, I'm afraid to use the word strategy in too many ways related to the military. You know, you serve 3 years in the military and you understand that, you know, strategy is quite a tough word for an institution that just operates. I would definitely say is that today Palestinian violence has gone to almost nothing. And the only thing left is children who throw stones. Yet that's the big threat in most cases. So that's what you end up dealing with. And you deal with it as if it's people who blow up buses, right? Because this is the resistance, so to speak, that you have now. And what is even more important to understand, and this is where I think this is a very important thing for all of us to understand, is that, sadly enough, in a reality of a prolonged occupation like we live in, for the average soldier, we don't care if it's a child or an adult. 10 years old, 20 years old, 50 years old, couldn't care less. Palestinians and us, good guys, bad guys. Enemies And enemies you treat the way you treat enemies. Yeah, I don't remember we treated children different than adults. Yeah, they were the same threat for us all the time. And in that sense, when you arrest someone and you throw in the back of the Jeep and give some slaps, it can be a child, and it can be a 20 years old. How do Israelis don't know? I think the answer is very simple, why they should know. Look, every time I speak outside of Israel, I try to explain it. The truth is that Israeli society is not the first society that is silent, and sadly enough, not the last society that is silent. Yeah, look, silence is not an Israeli disease. Silence is a human epidemic. When you don't look good, you don't spend too much time in front of the mirror. Yeah, and that's, it's very easy to look through a window at someone else. It's very difficult to paint one side dark and face a mirror. And by the way, this is why we always say that the day breaking the silence will be popular, it means we stop doing our job. Because by definition, our job is to spoil the party. It's to find our society in its most convenient moments and wreck it, and remind us that this is what we do. But there is many reasons why we're still silent. We're still silent because the media doesn't tell the story, because the army doesn't tell the truth, because we didn't speak with our parents. You know, you don't come back home Friday night dinner and tell to your mother, hey mom, these are two Palestinians I killed last night, isn't it cool? You don't do this. And because every journalist is first of all an Israeli. And the last thing that the average Israeli wants to believe is that our military does this. And this relates to your question from before. The last thing I wanted to believe is that I did this. Yeah? To tell you that there is one event that changed me? No, there is not one event that changed me. From the second I stepped into the occupied territories and started asking questions, my service is just a story of, you know, ups and downs. Questioning and forgetting the questions. And questioning and forgetting the questions, and doing this and doing that. I think, you know, I remember when I saw settlers beating up Palestinians, I tried to go and file complaints. When I saw the soldiers doing bad things, I tried to complain. I tried to leak out materials to the media during my service as a soldier. But the real change was the minute that I understood that all the questions I was asking and all the stuff that I've done complaining about others was my silence. Yeah, it was my way to continue to do the stuff I've done and still believe that I'm a good guy. Yeah, and that's the collapse. It's looking at yourself in the mirror and suddenly realizing that making your presence felt, even though it's a nice phrase, what it actually means. And suddenly realizing that three times a day standing in a briefing and reading from the briefing wall that the mission is to create the feeling of being chased inside the whole population, it's insane. But that's what was written there. Yeah, that's the real change. Yeah.
Useful place in this world. And do you speak to any Jewish congregations when you're on tour?
Thank you.
Yeah.
I come from a country that succeeded through occupation. So in America, we occupied this country in a very real sense. So I think that we have to understand that. But one of the things that is so strange to me is it seems that it's so self-destructive, obviously self-destructive, that this behavior, this occupation. And I can't believe it's just Netanyahu. I mean, Are there no wise men in Israel?
Let me just correct. I don't believe it's only Netanyahu. Yeah, this is 46 years, and it hasn't gone. Yeah, it's not, you know, it's not only Netanyahu. I just spoke about Netanyahu because he's now there in the chair. But I find it very difficult to think of any other prime minister apart from Yitzhak Rabin that really, in my eyes, that really thought of it, of something else. But that's, again, my own opinions. In terms of, you read a quote from a booklet in 2009, you. I don't know exactly that quote, but I think he refers to some booklets that we released. Look, what happened around Operation Cast Lead in Gaza in 2009 is, we don't have the time to go into it, yeah? It's another hour and a half to speak about military tactics of what happened in Gaza. And believe me, I think many people who are terrified with what happened in Gaza are terrified in a way not for the right reasons sometimes. I think in order to understand how crazy, how insane, and how immoral was a lot of the behavior of the military in Gaza in 2009, you need to be a military person. You need to understand the meaning of the ammunition that was used and the orders and in the ways and the rules of engagement that were given. Yeah, you need to know the details of what is the death radius of a shell and how much ammunition there is in a shell, explosives, and yeah? That's when you really become terrified, if you know these details. But apart from the military details around Operation Cast Lead that were terrifying, and I led the research of breaking the silence on Operation Cast Lead, and I remember, look, I served in the peak of the violence of the Second Intifada. Since the minute I left the military, all what I do is I swim and the wrongdoings of our military in the occupied territories. And the first 20 soldiers we interviewed coming out of Gaza back then, I just didn't believe them. They were describing a different military, a military that I didn't know. It is after we interviewed 40 people from different units, don't know each other, and they all spoke the same, that we understood, yeah, maybe the change that happened was so fundamental. And one of the things that soldiers came was the attitude, the atmosphere in the military. And the atmosphere in Operation Cast Lead was crazy. And part of it was also the military rabbinate and their preachings and their booklets that they handed out to soldiers. And yeah, they were very highly politicized booklets that were handed out to soldiers. A lot of racism in it. You know, stuff that I remember is stuff like, you know, oh, kind of like a Q&A with a rabbi. Are the Palestinians the same of the biblical Philistines or not? Yeah, and the answer is no. Philistines were here in the land. The Palestinians are not from this land. Yeah, they came only lately. You know, these kind of stuff, yeah? Things that have nothing to do. Yeah, nothing to do if you look at an objective way of what a military should tell their soldiers. Yeah, one of the things I'll never forget is a good friend of mine who served in Operation Cast Lead. He's also religious, also Orthodox soldier. And he was one day, before they went in to Gaza, they were in a shooting range, training, yeah, getting all the equipment ready. And he said that during a break, one of the military rabbis came to speak to the unit. And one of the things he told them, as he left, after his speech, he told them in Hebrew, "Al tishkechu, merkaz masa." Don't forget, to the center of the body. When you give rules of engagement in the military, and you tell people to shoot to kill, you don't aim at the head, because the head is a very small part of the body, you can miss. You aim to the center of the body in order to hit to kill. Now I bring this up not because I believe soldiers went into Gaza because of this talk and started killing people. No, because the rules of engagement that you follow in an operation doesn't come from a rabbi. It needs to come from the officer. But I bring this to describe the atmosphere. Yeah? If this kind of conversation can go on and no one takes something and hits this rabbi on the head, yeah, it tells us the atmosphere that the unit was in. My visit to the West Coast now in these 2 weeks is just a small part of a Breaking the Silence greater tour. My comrades have done a tour last month in the East Coast. They, and including I, will be speaking in a few synagogues, yeah. And I think that with this I covered the three questions. Any more? We should continue? Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
There was a second half of my question I'd still like to ask.
What was it? Sorry.
I asked you if this thoughtful military person, somebody who's concerned about the overall strategy in the Middle East, if you were a Palestinian, what kind of advice would you give to your fellow Palestinians in terms of the kind of response and strategy they can use?
I believe you said that you hope that your book will be read by teens in Israel. What can they do if they read it and realize what's going on? What do you desire their response to be?
I think one thing, somebody asked, who can do it and what can be done? I think we need to learn from it ourselves.
First, about the female soldiers' testimonies. It is not something I can speak for my own experience for obvious reasons, right? But I highly recommend you should go on our website, and under publications you can find a full booklet of a couple of dozen of stories by our female members. I think it's fascinating. I think it's very interesting. Look, female soldiers in the IDF, very, very few of them are in combat positions. The ones who serve in the occupied territories, most of them are not in combat positions. They can serve in non-combat positions inside combat units. So it's not just a gender issue of being with one foot in, 1 foot out, yeah? It's also just because you're in a combat unit and you're not in a combat position that you have 1 foot in, 1 foot out. And you know, the minute I understood that my female comrades in the military have a story to contribute was, it was already in the first exhibit that we've done in 2004. I remember I was, you know, look, we're not artists. We put together a photo exhibit not to display photos and the great work we've done with our cameras. Yeah, for us, the photos were a platform to tell the story of what we've done and what's going on in the occupied territories. So we were there in the gallery during the opening hours, taking people around, yeah, telling our personal story. And one day, I don't remember if it was the second or the third week of the exhibit, I was taking a group. And part of the group was Dana, a good friend of mine. She was our education NCO in my unit. She was there to teach us how nice we should behave, yeah, and what is right and what is wrong morally. And she was in the group together with her mother. And I'm walking around and telling the story of how numb you become, how in the first house that you break in and the children start to cry and pee in their pants from fear, you really feel something, but you can't really continue to feel because you need to do your job, which is to make them fear you all the time. So there is a limit to how much feeling you can feel. And in the next house, you're a bit less concerned. And after the fifth or sixth house, even if it's going into a house and locking the family in a basement just in order to turn on the TV and watch a soccer match, everything is cool. No problem with it. So, and I remember Dana looking at me during the tour and, you know, like with this weird face. So I thought, well, Dana, what do you want? And she tells me, Yehuda, you don't get the story, huh? You don't understand a picture. So what do you mean? She told me, look, Yehuda, you're talking about, oh, wow, you feel as a... Do you remember Uvda? Uvda in Hebrew is a word that stands for fact. That's the name of the kind of like the equivalent for 60 Minutes on Israeli TV. So when we came out, they did a whole program about breaking the silence. Yeah, we were, I said, a big news story, yeah? So Dana tells me, look, I was sitting down in a dining room, living room in our home, with my mother, watching the program. And it got to a place where one of my comrades was giving a testimony where he spoke about an ambush that we had that killed two Palestinian militants. It was a Friday night. And after killing these two militants, they brought the bodies back to the base. And they arrived right at the end of dinner, Friday night dinner. So everyone coming, not everyone, but dozens of people coming out of the dining room were standing in line, putting up the bodies and taking photos with them. So this guy, one of my comrades, is telling this story. He had this testimony on TV. And Dana says, my mother saw this story and she started crying. I looked at my mother and I said, hey, Mom, who do you think was washing the dishes? He saw it through the window, it didn't do anything. Yeah? It's at that moment that I understood that, you know, you don't need to be a combat, so you don't, it doesn't matter. You're there. You're there and you have a story to tell because you go through more or less the same stuff. And what's even worse than that is that as women inside military, especially inside combat units, you need to prove yourself. Yeah, that you're as good as men. And that means sometimes you need to be even way more aggressive. Right? You need to be more men than the men. But again, I don't want to speak on behalf too much on behalf of my comrades. I highly recommend you that you will go and read their own stories. If I was a Palestinian, what I would do against the occupation, I would resist nonviolently. Because I think that violence is our field, and we are way more stronger. Yeah? It's where they would take us to their field, we would lose. Massive nonviolent resistance. What do we tell the youth that we meet? The truth is that many times when we meet youth, they're very angry at us and they're very frustrated with us. And they always come and say, hey guys, you're coming telling us all this and you're not telling us what to do. Look, Breaking the Silence is not a refusenik group. We don't call on people to refuse to serve. Just like we don't call on people to serve. Not our job. Our job is to say the truth. And they would always come and say, hey, you can't just come here, tell us all this, and not tell us what to do. And my answer would always be, yes, we can. We're just doing it now. Now, I understand why they're angry. Yeah, because as teenagers, they're used to be fed what they should think about everything, what they should do. No, we're not here to solve their problems. We're here to create problems. Now, the most important thing here in that sense is I think the main thing that brings them to become so frustrated is that we don't have, if what we're trying to say in Breaking the Silence is that if you understand the story, you don't have a light at the end of the tunnel. It's only if you get out of the tunnel you'll see light. Yeah? And it's very frustrating because the only thing we can tell them is, look guys, you'll join the military, you'll be combat soldiers, you'll serve in the occupied territories. Best case scenario is 5 years from now, you stand here in front of a group on behalf of Breaking the Silence and talk about the crimes you committed. Because if you think you're going to serve there and change from within, nice to meet you. My name is Yehuda, I've been there, done that. And this is what I really did. And it's really frustrating. But that's what it is. Yeah.
Maybe a little too philosophical, but as an American after World War II, it's really saddened and disappointed me to see that the vast majority of the institutional Jewish world can look at the Holocaust and say, look what happened to us, never forget what happened to us, rather than look what happens when a powerful group of people tries to dehumanize less powerful groups of people.
So first of all, the first question was about conscientious objector inside Israel. Look, there is a refusenik movement in Israel. Yeah? Different ways, different levels, people refuse to different things. But I would say the most simple way to divide them is there is youngsters who refuse the draft, and there is reserve soldiers who refuse reserve duty. Because military service in Israel doesn't end after the 3 mandatory years. Yeah? If you are a combat soldier until the age of 40, every year, 1 month reserve duty. Okay? Now, there are people who refuse the draft, but that's very much at the fringe of the radical left. And usually they would serve between 3 months to a year and a half in jail in different scenarios. And there are people who refuse reserve duty. Some refuse at all, some refuse only service in the occupied territory, some refuse a weapon, you know. Yeah, different people refuse, yeah? And usually, this would be a bit more into the left, yeah, the hard left. Not radical left, not fringe, but it's definitely not mainstream. Yeah, and not widespread, but it's there. Yeah, there were throughout the years hundreds of people who refused as reservists to go into the occupied territories. Well, you don't agree with me? No, I just... this is very rare. This is, I think, from what I know, is very rare. Yeah? Conscripts who refuse during their time is very rare, from what I know. And I've been following it pretty closely. When you refuse reserve duty, it's between nothing to 1 month in jail. The policy today of the military, mainly, the strategy is not to send refuseniks to jail. Because the military understood that when people sat in jail, the movement is alive. So for example, I have a good friend of mine who is called for years back again and again into the military. And he's a refuseniks. He refuses to even wear a uniform today. And he shows up in the base. And when they ask him to take uniform and a weapon, he says, no, I'm not going to be part of it. And then he is asking to be trialed and sent to jail. And then they tell him, oh, we'll check. So he stays in the base without uniform because he doesn't want to go home because he doesn't want them to put him on trial for deserting the call. He says, you want to put me in jail? Put me for what I want to go to jail for, not for what you want me to go to jail for. And sometimes he spends 2-3 weeks in a base until his call ends and they refuse to put him on trial. And only when everybody is sent home, he goes home. Yeah, because he doesn't want, again, he's willing to go to jail, but for what he believes, he should go to jail. Yeah, so there is an attempt to try not to put people in jail. Again, not refuseniks to the draft, but refuseniks to... I must tell you that for me, the Holocaust was, for me, the way I look at Jewish history was one of the things that brought me to where I am today. Yeah? It was one of the things that, and it's not that I think that what we do there is, you know, equivalent by any way and any mean to genocide and to Holocaust. Yeah, but it's the sensitivity that I think the history of our people created inside of people around me that we had to ask the questions. I think, sadly enough, for too many people in Israel, we are victims is something very, very strong in our identity. But I can tell you something. This is not something I believe in. after what I've seen and after what I've done in the occupied territories, no one can convince me that I'm the victim. Yeah? I'm not a victim. I'm a victimizer. For your question, if I was now 18, knowing what I know, would I would still enlist or not? That's a tough question that I don't think I can answer. I'll tell you why. The way I look at it is that if I knew what I know today, like, I wouldn't be me. I wouldn't be, like, if I, the way I think of it is that, you know, there's two kind of children. You know, there's those that mommy and daddy tell them fire is dangerous. Fire is dangerous. So they don't play with fire. They know fire is bad. They don't play with fire. And there's this kid that's out. Even though mommy and dad said that it's dangerous, he puts the hand in and he gets burned. Hoo-ah, he will never touch fire again, right? So I'm one of those who went into the stove. And I can never be, yeah, the person that I'm that I'm not. Like, I was burnt. I can never go. I you know, it's not something that I can even consciously I can even grasp. Yeah, so that's it, more or less. A bit to relate to a question that was asked earlier, a comment that I didn't relate to earlier. And I think this touches a bit of why I'm here. Yeah, we're very far away from Israel. Why the hell should I come here? Yeah, apart from the fact that you have a beautiful city. And apart from the fact that Judith is there. Look, I look at the act of breaking the silence as an act of taking responsibility. Yeah, when I understood what I've done, when I understood what we're doing, I didn't really have a choice. I didn't have too much of an option. Yeah, you come to understand that when these things take place, there is only two sides you can take. Either you're for it or against it. Yeah, remaining silent is, I know that these atrocities are happening, but I prefer my latte with two spoons of sugar, please. And that's what we are here to do, is to ask you to break your silence. Yeah, take the phrase breaking the silence out of the context of veterans who speak out. Yeah, and to take responsibility. Thank you very, very much for coming. I'll just remind you, there's books in the back. You can register to our email list and get more updates about new publications and get more informed. Pass on the information we publish and educate others. And break the silence, please. Thanks.